Go to the first session of research papers, and I will invite Dr. Shobha L. To chair this session. Let me introduce Dr. Shobha L. She has been the co-chair of WILDRE right from its inception and a very well-known researcher in NLP. She had a PhD in IIT Kanpur, and then she is currently working in AU Anna University KBC Research Center in the Linguistics Department, Linguistic Research Group, and she's currently heading that. And we have worked together for many projects and many research collaborations. And she is a well-known researcher and academician, and I'm very happy to invite her to chair the research paper session. Looks like Dr. Shobha is not there. Let me then invite Professor S.S. Agarwal, the eminent speech scientist that India has produced. So let me introduce Professor S.S. Agarwal. He is an eminent speech scientist and has been instrumental in creating speech technology for Indian languages, particularly Hindi. And he's currently heading the KIIT in Gurugram and has been very, very supportive for all our initiatives that we do on language technology. He has even participated in many panel discussions that we have had before in international fora and is very familiar with the work we do and has been very kind in accepting our offer to co-chair this event of WILDRE. So I invite Professor S.S. Agarwal to kindly chair this session. And there are five papers selected after tough blind review by three eminent reviewers. And I'm sure you will enjoy this session on NLP with S.S. Agarwal and five other researchers. Professor Agarwal, please carry on.
I cannot.
Please unmute yourself. Yeah,
now I can hear because my mic was muted. Yeah. Can you hear me all?
Yes, we can.
Yeah. So thank you. Many thanks, Professor Girish Jha, for inviting me and giving me this opportunity to chair this very important session. And I'm glad that this important workshop is now being organized in online fashion. So at least all the participants can listen to the important lectures and the papers. So it's a very good move. I congratulate you, Professor Girish. So let me start this session. And since I do not have the list of the papers, I would request you to announce the first paper. And please let me do it. Please tell me how much time is given for each paper.
So we have a session for about 1.5 hours, and we have five papers.
Okay.
So no call. You decide. First paper is from IIT Bombay, Vijayanand Randhan.
Okay.
And other lot of speakers, including Professor Bhattacharya himself.
Okay, sure.
Introduction for Marathi.
Right. So I invite the first paper who is presenting.
Can sorry, sir. Each paper has only 15 minutes.
How much?
15 minutes.
15 minutes, fine, yeah. So can you announce the title of the first paper and invite the first speaker?
In Marathi, the presenters are Gajanan Rane, Nilesh Joshi, Gitanjali Rane, Hanumant Redkar, Malhar Kulkarni.
Okay, so I invite them to...
Yeah,
please.
Is Gajanan Rane there?
Professor Malhar, sir.
Malhar Kulkarni ji, please load your PPT.
Okay. Hello. Hello, all.
Yeah, Professor Malhar, please go ahead.
Yes. So, is my presentation visible to all of you?
I see a black, yeah, there you go.
Yeah, right, there is a presentation.
Okay, yes. So the title of this presentation is Part of Speech Annotation Challenges in Marathi. This is written by scholars whose names were taken by Professor Girish Najjar. I thank him. This research was carried out in the Center for Indian Language Technology, CFILT, at Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, headed by Professor Pushpak Bhattacharya. I thank him. The outline of this presentation is the following: introduction, Marathi annotated corpora, Marathi part of speech tag set, lexical and functional part of speech tagging, challenges and discussions, part of speech ambiguity, challenges and discussions, some special cases, and then we will summarize. So part of speech annotation is the process of marking or annotating a word in a text or corpus which corresponds to a particular part of speech. The annotation is done based on its definition and its context, that is the relationship of that word with the adjacent and related words in a phrase or a sentence or sometimes even a paragraph. Part of speech annotation is a standard low-level text pre-processing step before moving to higher levels in the NLP pipeline, like chunking, dependency parsing, and so on and so forth. Identification of the part of speech tags, such as nouns, verbs, adjectives, adverbs for each word in the sentence, helps in analyzing the role of each word in a sentence. Marathi part of speech tagging was part of an Indian Language Corpora Initiative project executed at IIT Bombay, headed by Professor Girish Nath Jha at JNU. Marathi part of speech tag set can be described in this slide. The Bureau of Indian Standards came up with a standard set of tags for annotating data for Indian languages. The BIS tag set aims to ensure standardization in the part of speech tagging process across Indian languages. The tag sets of all Indian languages have been drafted by MITI and presented as unified POS standard in Indian languages. Marathi part of speech tag set has been prepared at IIT Bombay, referring to the standard BIS POS tag set and IIT Hyderabad guideline document, as well as Konkani part of speech tag set. Here is the Marathi part of speech tag set. Now let me talk about Marathi annotated corpora. In Marathi, currently there is around 100,000 sentences annotated data developed at IIT Bombay as a part of ILCI corpus, ILCI project funded by MIT Delhi, New Delhi. The ILCI corpus consists of four domains: is tourism, health, agriculture, and entertainment. And there are some general domain sentences as well. And this is the breakup of the sentences of the data. Tourism has 25,000 parallel corpus, health has 25,000, agriculture has 10,000, entertainment has 10,000, and general is 30,000. And it is also monolingual. This tagged data is used for various applications in NLP called, obviously, chunking, dependency tree ranking, and word sense disambiguation, right, in the NLP pipeline, but other applications as well, some of which were described by Anup in his keynote address. These data, ILCI annotated data, form a baseline for Marathi part of speech tagging and is available for a download at TDIL. There are two basic approaches for part of speech tagging, and the rest of the presentation is devoted to some challenges in these two. The lexical way of doing the part of speech tagging and the functional way of doing the part of speech tagging. The lexical approach deals with tagging a word at a token level, an independent token level, whereas functional part of speech tagging deals with tagging of a word as a syntactic function of a word in a particular sentence. So to give you an example, in the phrase golf stick, the part of speech tag of the word golf could be determined as follows. So golf is lexically a noun as given in the lexicon, and the name of a game or something like that would be given as the meaning. But when you look at the word golf stick here, its function is to modify the noun stick. So functionally, it is an adjective, as it is a modifier of succeeding noun. And therefore, we must decide as to which approach we must follow, lexical or the functional part of speech tagging. And there are challenges in these. Let us look at some of these challenges. Lexical and functional part of speech tagging, challenges and discussions. And there are several that we have numbered. They are also part of our paper. In paper, they are dealt with in with some little more elaboration. Here, for the want of time, I would not be able to elaborate on each and every one of them. But I will quickly go through those types. For example, subordinates which act as adverbs. Ja pramane, tya pramane, ya pramane, jevha, tevha, etc. So, ja pramane and ya pramane, these are generated from the pronominal basis stems, namely ja and ya. They are lexically qualified as pronouns, and hence they can be lexically tagged as pronouns. However, when they are used in a particular sentence, in that particular context, they may function as adverbs, and hence they need to be functionally tagged as adverbs, and the tag for adverbs is RB. When these words appear as part of the clause, then they should be functionally tagged as the CCS. Words with suffixes. In Marathi, there are some words to which some certain suffixes are added. So there are suffixes like mule, which means because of or due to, and sati or barobar, etc. When these suffixes are attached to pronouns, then the pronouns can still lexically be tagged as a pronouns, personal pronouns, and so on. However, when they are functioned, when they are attached with these suffixes, they functionally behave as coordinators, and they have to be therefore tagged as CCD. Then there is a case of words which are adjectives and which can be functionally an adverb. Consider the example below. Tyachyamadhye hi kala paramparagat chalat aali aahe. So this art came down to him by tradition. So if you concentrate on the word paramparagat, so something that has come down in the tradition. So the word paramparagat is lexically an adjective because it might modify a noun. But in this sentence, the verb is chalat aali aahe, has come down, and paramparagat is modifying this action of coming down. Here it is not modifying the noun kala, art, but it is rather modifying the verb. And therefore, in this above sentence, because it is qualifying the verb chalat yene to be practiced, hence functionally, the word paramparagat should be tagged as the adverb, namely the RB. The other set of issues are related to these mentioned, three are mentioned on this slide. Add nominal suffixes attached to verbs and how to deal with them, challenges and differences. The add nominal suffix zoga and its all its forms zoga, zogi, zoge, zogya, which means similar, are always attached to verbs. For example, karanya zogya. So something that is doable, something that is yogya to do, is it should be lexically tagged as a verb main, because it is modifying the verb karane and so on. However, the word karanya is a kridanta form of the word karane, and the suffix zoga is an ad nominal suffix attached to this kridanta form. And hence, a verb with all the forms of zoga should functionally be treated as adjectives. and therefore verbs with adnominal suffixes should be tagged as adjectives. And if he kaam karnyajoga ahe, in this karnyajoga will definitely modify the noun kaam and so on. And the gender will also be marked accordingly, and therefore it is to be tagged as an adjective. Similarly, words jase and tase. So words jase like this and tase like that, they should be lexically tagged as adverbs. But these words function as a relative pronoun in a given sentence. So these are to be tagged as relative pronouns. The word tase tara, the third word on the slide, the tase tara, as it is seen, is the same as tase pahile tara, a shortened version of tase pahile tara. Lexically, it should be tagged as a particle, RPD, but it is, in this case, behaving like a conjunction in sentences, and therefore, in this corpus, and therefore, this should be tagged as conjunction. The word matra is very peculiar in Marathi. It is very ambiguous and it has got various usages. So it is very difficult to pinpoint and say that this word will have only one part of speech tag. It will have several tags depending on the function it plays in a given sentence in the corpus. So when the word matra, I'm on the fourth bullet on the slide, when the word matra conveys the meaning he, Nikhil, Sudha, also, which means also, then it should be tagged as adverb because it is going to modify the verb. When a word is related to the preceding word tethe, which means there, and its function is an emphatic marker, ch, then it should be tagged as RPD, which is an emphatic marker here, a function, functionally. When the word matra appears in the form of conjunction, then it should be marked as CC, obviously. Sometimes it may modify a succeeding noun and then it should be tagged as adjective. It might modify a preceding word where it can be tagged also as a particle, RPD. This was a very peculiar case as far as the word matra is concerned. And even in the
Professor Kulkarni, sorry to interrupt, you have only 2 minutes left.
Yes, so I am aware of that and I wanted to finish that slide. Now I will not go through all these slides. I will straight away go to the summaries, but I can quickly skim through these slides and say that we have more number of cases discussed in the paper. Those who are interested may, you know, go through them in the paper. There are some part of speech ambiguities as well that we have discussed. Some ambiguous words, te, tehi, etc., they can also be seen. An interesting case is the negative particle, which is part of the verb, asu de naka, which acts as an ambiguous item in the form of ka, and it can be also disambiguated given the context. On this slide, there is mention of the word ulta, which also can be tagged as an adverb as well as an adjective. Okay. Is also a unique one, and there are some special cases, but I'll skip this and I'll go straight away to the summary now. So Marathi part of speech tagging is an important activity for NLP tasks and in various functions. While tagging, several challenges and issues are encountered. In this paper, the Marathi Bureau of Indian Standard Taxet is mentioned and discussed. Lexical and functional tagging approaches are also discussed and several examples are provided, and how things will work out using both these approaches is also stated and the difference is also noted. Further, various challenges and experiences and special cases have been presented. The issues discussed here will be helpful for annotators, researchers, language learners, etc. of Marathi, not just Marathi but also of other languages. In future, more issues such as tagging for words having multiple senses, words having multiple functional tags will be also discussed. Also, tacit comparison of close languages, related languages, will also be done. Further, the evaluation of lexical and functional tagging using statistical analysis will also be done. And these are the references which we have used for our paper. Thank you so much. That's all from our side.
So thank you very much, Professor Malhar Kulkarni, for a very nice presentation.
Thank you.
I don't know if somebody is ready with a question they can ask, or we can leave the questions interested persons can directly communicate.
Yes. So can I stop sharing?
Can you close your PPT, please?
Yes.
Yeah. Now anybody who raises a hand will be unmuted, and then we can take the question.
I think Mr. Manish want to ask a question. So can you mute him?
Manish. Tulji, can you unmute Manish? Yeah. Manish, can you unmute yourself? I'm clicking unmute. Did Manish raise hand? No.
I think so. Yeah.
Shalini Sahni, there's so many hands. So many hands. Okay. Let's see, who are they all for this paper, or let's see. Let me unmute Prabhu Dayal. Malhar, you want to ask a question? No, Malhar is there already. Okay. Atulji, can you unmute Prabhu Dayal? Just raise your hand, whosoever wants to ask a question, raise your hand like this. Anybody who wants to ask a question, raise your hand.
I think, Professor Jha, we can go to the next paper.
Yes. So I thank the chair, and I also thank Professor Girishnath Jha, and I also thank all my co-authors. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Professor Malhar.
Yeah. Just 1 second. Can we send Malhar's email to all so that they can send queries to Malhar directly?
Sure. Yeah.
Atulji, please send Malhar's email ID to all. So that Shiladit, please send Malhar's email ID to all so that they can.
Okay, sir.
We'll go to the next paper now. The next paper is since you may not have the schedule, Professor Agrawal, with you, let me help you on that.
Yeah, I think so. Please, yeah.
A data set for Troll, a classification of Tamil memes. Mm-hmm. Shardul Suryavanshi, Bharati Raja Chakravarti. Mihail Arkan, Paul Butler, Data Science Institute, National University of Ireland, Galway. So I invite them to, please go ahead, sir. Is Shardul having difficulty in sharing the screen? Hello, Shardul, are you there? Shardul, can you identify yourself?
I was not able to unmute myself.
Okay, good. So
yeah,
Shardul, are you able to share your screen?
Yeah. I'll share. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, it's there. Yes.
Do you see my screen?
Yeah, we can see that.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Hi, everyone. I am Shardul Suryavanshi, and today I'm going to present my initial research on detecting offensive content in images, which has been done using a data set for troll identification of Tamil memes. And this work has been co-authored by Bharati Raja Chakravarti, Dr. Mihail Arkan, and Paul Butler. So before jumping into the main content, I would like to outline the today's presentation. Firstly, I will start with our definition of the troll meme, how we define troll meme, and proceeding, we will talk about the challenges we came across while gathering and developing this data set, and the data set annotation and agreement that we achieved once we collected the data, and experimental setup for the data set for the experiments and methodology that we followed. And finally, we will discuss the result and conclude the presentation. So a troll meme, as we defined, is mostly a combination of offensive text with a non-offensive image, or offensive image with a non-offensive text, or it could be a sarcastically offensive text with a non-offensive image. So the main motto behind a troll meme is to provoke the audience and distract them with digressive and off-topic comment. So the intention of a troll is to demean and offend individual or a group. If you see this example is targeting a product or a company by saying that the translation of this text goes like, if you buy one packet of air, then you get 5 chips free. That means they are damaging your company reputation, and in a way they are trying to manipulate the opinion of the audience exposed to this meme. So if you see in the example, the text they are using is also a code, it's code mixed because we have a Tamil script along with English words. So that is also one of the dimension of the problem. So from here onwards, I'll be talking about the challenges. So one of the biggest challenge was to finding out the context. When we gathered images from our volunteers from different social medias. So we got a lot of duplicate images. So we had to, it was easy to remove duplicate images, but the images which had different text, we had to go through that manually, and we kept the images which were similar, but the different, with a different text. So both the images, they represent the same idea, but the translation for them goes differently, as you can see in this slide. So another challenge was data imbalance and the low resource. As you know that when we go on social media and try to collect offensive or troll meme, it is hard to find because sometimes it gets removed, and sometimes you need a lot of observation to identify a troll meme. So we collected all the troll memes from our volunteers, and we sent it across to our annotators for annotating. And once we got the annotation, we found out that we had a class imbalance. So we had to add some of the images in the not troll classes. For that, we used Flickr dataset. Flickr dataset is basically used for explanation tasks. Like if you see this image, the text caption for this image is a lady cooking, baking a cake. And then we have this image of a lady baking a cake. It's in a way, it's not a troll because there's no text associated with, and it's non-targeted content. So we added such images into our not troll category to achieve class balance. And this was one of the important factor while annotating the data, because our annotators might have to go through a lot of emotional toll because the offensive and troll content is not really smooth with your processing, and hence we asked annotators to leave on their own will if they want to leave the annotation process. So we allowed them to do so. So after doing this, first of all, like for annotation, we had two annotators, one male and one female. We achieved gender balance by doing so, and after a round of annotation and updation of guidelines, we achieved agreement and in terms of Cohen's kappa, which is 0.62, which you can say substantial agreement. And in case of conflict, we asked our third expert annotator to resolve the conflict and label the data. And in the end, we were able to gather overall 2,969 memes, amongst which 1,951 were trolls and rest 1018 were not trolls. So the experimental setup for this is we used basically image classifier to classify these troll into these images into troll or non-troll categories. We used ResNet and MobileNet classifier, which are part of convolutional neural networks, and we tested this classifier in imbalanced data setting and balanced data setting. So these were the variations of our experiments. The first variation is solely trained on our own data set. In second variation, where we used ImageNet pre-trained version of ResNet and MobileNet. And later we added 30,000 Flickr images into not troll categories, and that was our third variation. And in the fourth variation, used a balanced data set by adding only 1,000 Flickr images into pre-trained Tamil meme variation. So the methodology is basically to use the visual cues from the image and capture some abstract feature from the image to identify a troll or not troll category. So yeah. So these are the results from ResNet model. I won't go into the details for ResNet because I don't have that much time. If you want, you can go through the paper. But basically, ResNet is a very complex model compared to MobileNet. And you can see over here that the precision that we achieved never goes beyond 0.37. And in case of Tamil memes variation, we get the highest precision with ResNet, which shows that ResNet is capable of learning all the features just on the basis of the memes, just on the basis of our own data set. But in case of pre-trained ImageNet network, we are getting slightly less precision, which is also not that significantly less. But in case of balanced data set, ResNet performs poorly with the precision of 0.30. And in case of imbalanced data set where we added 30,000 images into non-troll categories, it shows 0.36 precision. And overall, we have similar microaverage precision recall and F1 score in each category, except the third one, where we achieved little lesser score in microaverage precision recall and F score. And if you go into the mobile net, you can see over here that the first baseline Tamil memes is giving the least precision. That means mobile net being a convolutional neural network designed for mobiles and embedded vision applications cannot learn the features from the image to classify troll or non-troll category. While on the other hand, if we add pre-trained image net weights, it shows improvement in the performance in terms of precision and in terms of macro average score as well. And in balanced condition, also it performs better with the macro average score of 0.5 in each precision recall and F1 score. But in case of imbalanced settings, in the fourth variation, we are getting lesser micro average score as well as lesser precision. So MobileNet performs poorly in imbalanced settings, while on the other hand, ResNet performance was not hampered by imbalanced data set. So to summarize overall result, we can see that microaverage F1 score with or without data imbalances ranged from 0.47 to 0.58, which is not significantly better. And overall precision for troll class identification lied in range of 0.28 and 0.37, which is also not significant. And as I said, ResNet was not hampered by imbalanced setting, while on the other hand, MobileNet showed poor performance in imbalanced setting. So to conclude this, we found out that image classifier does not give a significant result. As you have already seen, our precision didn't go beyond 0.38. And text embedded on a meme gives that meme a meaning, but we did not consider text while classifying the image. So we have to consider to extend this, where we have to consider the text associated with the meme, and also the text is in a code mixed nature with English and Tamil scripts, and yeah, it is rather challenging to train a classifier just on the basis of image. And and as I have shown you in third slide, there are like different context of the image when you change the text of the image, and yeah, we have to consider that as well while extending this work. And we plan to use OCR technique to capture this textual data and treat this problem in multimodal way for the future work. So yeah, that's the future direction for the work. And yeah, thank you. If you have any question, I'm open for it.
So thank you very much, Shardul, for a nice presentation. And we can have some questions now. Can you raise your hands? Can I have the full screen?
Shardul, can you close the
share? Oh, I'll, yeah.
Let me get the full screen. Anybody who wants to ask a question, please raise your hand like this so that the chair can see it. And then we can unmute you. Anybody who wants to share, who wants to ask a question? Raise your hand. Lakshmi. Lakshmi, you want to ask?
No, sir.
Okay.
Ritesh has one question.
Ritesh.
Sardul, Ritesh asks, did you measure a random baseline and what was the scores?
So basically idea behind this was to just classify a troll meme on the basis of the image. So we tested it in the complex and lightweight settings. So we just wanted to see if we were able to classify the image just on the basis of visual cues. So we selected some of the well-known techniques instead of very complex and the state of the art. So yeah, that was not random, but yeah, we went with the popular baselines.
Anybody else? So I think if there are no more questions, we thank Shardul for a very nice presentation, and the questions can be asked to him and by sending an email.
Yeah, our student Shiladil, can you send Shardul's email to all so that he can they can ask questions to him directly, right? Okay. Now, should I read out the next presenter's name?
Please, sir. Yeah.
Lakshmi KR is the name.
Lakshmi KR.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. Then we go to Lakshmi KR, Malayalam Speech Corpus Design and Development for Dravidian Languages. KR from IIITM Trivandrum. Please. Lakshmi KR, yes. Please load your PPT, Lakshmi.
Yes, sure, sir.
Sure, wonderful.
So it's we able save to, time. Able to okay. See for you, all of
very
you.
Very good, yeah.
Okay, good evening, sir. So thankful, thank you so much for the workshop coordinators for selecting my paper for the oral presentation.
And Lakshmi, can you raise the volume of your microphone?
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
It's able to hear now?
Yeah, yes. Very good. Yes.
Okay. So my paper, we are presenting the paper, Malayalam Speech Corpus Design and Development for Dravidian Language. So moving to the paper. So.
Yes.
Paper is to overpass the disparity between theory and applications in language-related technology, text as well as speech, and several other areas. A well-designed and well-developed corpus is essential. So, the Malayalam Speech Corpus (MSE) is one of the first speech corpora for automatic speech recognition. It consists of 250 hours of agricultural speech data. and the work is focuses on the transcription file, lexicon, and annotated speech along with the audio segment, and it is available for the public use upon the request at the following URL. So moving to the introduction, Malayalam is the official language of Kerala, Lakshadweep and Mahi, and from 1330 million people in India, 37 million people speak Malayalam, that is 2.88% of Indians. So Malayalam is the youngest of all languages in the Dravidian family. 4 or 5 decades were taken for Malayalam to emerge from Tamil. Malayalam is greatly influenced by Sanskrit too. So the ASR have many works progressing for in low resource languages. To increase the accuracy of such ASR system, the speech data for low resource languages like Malayalam is to be increased. To encourage the research on speech technology and its related applications in Malayalam, a collection of speech corpus is commissioned and named as Malayalam Speech Corpus. This corpus consists of the following. So we divide it into two parts. That is the 200 hours of narrational speech named NS and 50 hours of interview speech that is named as IS. And the raw speech data that we obtained or collected from the Kisan Krishadeepam, an agriculture-based air and web-based program in Malayalam by the Department of Agriculture, Government of Kerala. And NS is created by making a script during the post-production stage and dubbed with the help of people in different age groups and gender, but they are amateur dubbing artists. So the literature survey that are mostly related to the low resource language development and design of the speech corpora is all of us know that English is very readily available speech corpus, and it's freely available too. And TED Talk speech collection is also available. That's also in English language. And in Malayalam, there's a database available for the emotion recognition. And coming to the same way, a work is done on the contributed in Latvian language, and they created a 100 hours of orthographically transcribed audio data. And in addition to that, a 4 hours of phonetically transcribed audio data is also available in Latvian language. Similarly, another work that has done on the low resource language is South Africa. In South Africa, that South Africa has 11 official languages, and they made an attempt to create speech corpora for these under-resourced languages, and they made a collection of speech corpora for 50 hours of speech in each 11 languages, and it's available also. And a speech corpora collection is done on Northeast Indian low resource languages also created. So moving to our work, that is, as I mentioned earlier, we divided the speech corpora into narrational and interview speech corpora. So the narrational speech corpora, the written agricultural script, which is phonetically balanced and phonetically rich, was given to the speakers to record the narrational speech. The scripts are in different in content, and the speakers or the narrators were given enough time to record the data, and any recording issues happened after rectification by the recording assistant, it will be re-recorded. And you can see an example of the script that is given for the narrator to record. That is an example of a narrational speech is given, is shown over the screen. So the narrational speech is less expensive than interview speech, and because it is difficult to get the data for the ASR system in the case of interview speech, and the IS data is collected in a face-to-face interview style. That is, the interviewee with enough experience in the field of cultivation is asked to speak up. What are its features, what type of fertilizers he used, and what all insects is happening, all those something that's related to his field of cultivation he used to speak, and the interviewer who's asking the questions. So, hello?
Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay. The interviewer is a subject expert in the area of cultivation, and both of them have used separate microphones for their purposes. And we face these challenges during recording the speech corpus, and the background noise is the main issue in collecting the interview speech, because sounds of vehicles, animals, irrigation motor, wind, everything will affect the recording of the interview speech. And the another difficulty that we faced is the interview speech is collected by the farmers or the agriculture experts in almost all the districts in Kerala. So they have different pronunciation styles, and that will affect the interview speech corpora when it is coming to the place of ASR field. And the recording will be go up to for 5 to 6 hours depending on the speakers, or in to using the microphone, it will extend, the time will extend, and that will also a challenge that we face during the recording of the speech corpora. And we have set few speaker criteria for recording the narrational speech, and the speakers at the minimum age of 18, they're citizens of India, speakers are residents of Kerala, and the mother tongue of speaker should be Malayalam without any specific accent. So the narrational speech is narrating what is happening in the coming part of interview of the particular farmer. So that narrator should have a proper Malayalam without any specific accent. Then moving to the recording criteria, we used a standing microphone for recording the NS corpora, and IS corpora is collected directly from the farmers using recording portable mic at their place. And for NS, we used a Shure SM58LC cardioid vocal microphone without cable. For IS, Sennheiser XSW1ME2 wireless presentation microphone of range 548 to 578 megahertz, and Stain Newt Pro tools are used for audio post-production processes. And the audio is recorded in 48 kilohertz sampling frequency and 16-bit sampling rate for broadcasting, and the same is shown. Same is downsampled to 16 kilohertz sampling frequency and 16-bit sampling rate for speech-related research purposes. And the recording speech corpora are saved in WAV files also. And while after we collecting the speech corpora,
yes, please go ahead.
Corpus both have male and female speakers, and the NS, the male speakers and the female speakers are made up with 75% and 25% respectively. And while at the case of IS, the ratio is changed to 82% and 18%. And another demographics that we got after collecting the data are place of cultivation and type of cultivation. That is shown in the table. The place of cultivation that 12 different districts in Kerala, and its corresponding percentage in demographics is percentage is shown over here, and same as type of cultivation, and here animal husbandry, you can see apiculture, dairy, fruits and vegetables, horticulture, poultry, terrace farming. These are the different type of cultivation that are doing in all over the Kerala, the 12 districts that mentioned earlier, and the percentage is shown on the next column. And then moving to the transcription, so we have providing the audio segment, then we are providing the transcription file, and these files are transcribed with the transcribers have given the audio segments that the speaker read, and their task is to transcribe the content of the audio into Malayalam into phonetic text. So and we are providing, this is an annotated speech corpora that is providing to the research for the research purposes. And this is an example of a transcription file. So as I told earlier, this is an example of an NS corpora. So NS corpora, we are providing the transcription file, in that the Malayalam text will be there, and its corresponding phonetic notation will be there, and it's almost it is translated into English, and that meaning is also given with the transcription file. So an example of 3 sentences are given, and this is another example of interview speech. So it's an interview of it's a face-to-face interview between the interviewer and interviewee. So the answers of the questions and its answers as given, as shown earlier, it's in Malayalam content and phonetic style, and meaning in English also given as a given in the transcription file. And moving to the next part, we have given the audio segment, transcription file, annotated speech corpora. Along with that, we are giving the lexicon also. So pronunciation dictionary lexicon contains a collection of 4,925 unique words. As of now, the audio collection process is still going on, which will increase the lexicon size. And we are giving the word the lexicon and for phoneme level and syllable level also we are giving. And it's the primary natural mode of communication, and we can extract more linguistic information from speech, like emotions, accent, everything from the speech. And it will be speech related applications is more useful for illiterate and old people. And the articulatory and acoustic information can be obtained from a good audio recording environment. To encourage the academic research in speech related applications, a good number of multilingual and multipurpose speech corpora for Indian languages is required. So the role of this language corpora is very significant to preserve and maintain a linguistic heritage of our country. So the release of MSC Malayalam speech corpus will be one of the corpora that is contributing 200 hours of narrational speech and 50 hours of interview speech data for public use, and lexicon annotated speech corpora and transcription files also made available with the data, and the updates are available in the IITMK site with the given URL. And these are the few references. And thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much, Lakshmi, for a nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
And we now request the audience to ask some questions.
Can she close her PPT presentation first? Okay.
Sure, sir. I will close it. Okay.
Anybody asking questions can raise hand like this, and then we can unmute them. Sharadit, can you send Lakshmi's email ID to all so that they can? Okay. Atulji, can you unmute Pushpak? I think he has a question.
Kar diya hai, sir. Kar diya hai.
Pushpak, can you hear us? I think I saw your comment. I was raising hand. Maybe you can unmute everyone to see if anyone is trying to ask a query.
Okay, sir. Sabko unmute kar diya hu.
Shila Aditya, please send. Shila Aditya, please send Lakshmi's ID to everybody.
Sir, problem hoga.
Atulji, unmute me, please.
Sir, fir se sabko select karna pad raha hai bar bar.
Okay.
Karna padega na?
Haan.
Okay.
If you want to ask question, they can unmute their microphone also.
Okay, we can go to the next one.
Are nahi hamare paas aapka number likha hua hai.
So Atul, am I audible now?
Yes, yes.
So can I continue my presentation?
Sure, sure. Please continue.
Yeah, first I'd like to apologize. There are some technical issues here. So I have to change my
Shanti Priya, just wait. I'm going to unmute all people. Mute all people and then yes, Shanti Priya, please continue.
So Professor
Yes.
Professor Agrawal, the next presenter, Shanti Priya.
Yeah, I have been unmuted, so
yeah,
it's okay now. I can speak now. Yes. Yeah, so Shanti Priya, please start your presentation. You are welcome.
Yeah. Thank you, sir, and apologize from myself. There was some technical issues.
Well, no problem. Odisha is having difficult times.
Yeah, thank you for all of your understanding. And yes. So let me start my presentation. First, I'd like to thank all the co-authors of the papers. So this is the paper is about building a parallel corpus for Odia English So mostly the idea is to build a parallel corpus which will be suitable for neural machine translations. So let me just introduce the course.
Bigger, Shantipriya, so, can you presentation more, which is a big screen, so that the on the phone it will look nicer.
Yeah.
The presentation mode will make it full screen.
Yeah. So is it okay, sir?
Well, you are still in the slide mode.
Put the presentation on the screen mode.
Don't worry. Just continue. Please.
It's okay. Yeah. Otherwise, also this will work. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So, so the co-authors are Dr. Satyarandan Das and Professor Andres Boyer from Charles University and Peter Motilik from here, EDF Research Institute, and Priyanka Patnaik and Devasis Kumar Malik from KIIT University, Bhubaneswar. So the agenda is, we'll talk about the necessity of this parallel corpus with the data sources. From where we collected the data and how we process the data, then the final data size of this corpus and the domain which cover the data set, as well as we have the baseline for the NMT baselines and the availability of the corpus with the conclusion. The as everyone knows that ODI, it's an Indian language, which is a branch of Indo-Aryan branch of Indo-European language family, and it is one of the official language of India, and also it is the sixth Indian language, which is designated as a classical language. And the main problem what we observe is that there was not much means there is not machine translation systems available for English to ODIA. Although just very recently, Google has introduced ODIA in their machine translation systems, but still that quality is not very good, which I can say. And I think other machine translation companies, Microsoft and other big companies, they're trying to incorporate ODIA. The major problem was that there was a lack of parallel corpus for English ODIA, and some of the parallel corpus, well, we also found, but they are either their size is small or they are covering only few domains, and these are not very suitable for machine translations. So in this direction, this is our second attempt. So first, we have already released a ODIAN Corp 1.0. So, but that was mostly, we selected some sentences from Parallel Bible and some of the government sites and some of the URLs, but that size was not very big. And the major problem what we found is that that was not very suitable for machine translation, which is based on neural approach or neural NMT systems. Although it was good for phrase-based, but now all the new models or new approach or new translation systems all follows this or NMT based. So all these reasons motivates us to going for extend this ODIAN Corp 1.0, and we developed this.
Shantipriya, please keep in mind that you have limited time.
Yes, sir.
It's not invited talk for 1 hour.
Yes, sir.
So please, you have a lot of slides to show.
Yes, sir. So I'll try to briefly explain everything. So the major data sources what we found, we tried to check all the options, like all the online resources where the English ODIA parallel data are available. Also, we checked the ODIA Wikipedia, and recently we found a lot of articles. And also we tried OCR-based techniques. So where we found, although ODIA language, there is not much online contents are available, but ODIA language has very strong and very long literary values, and they are many texts and literatures are available. So textual contents, it's a plenty of texts are available. So we selected some of the textbooks and other books where we can get some parallel data, English and Odia. So only thing is that to extract those data, we have used the OCR-based technique. So if somebody interested, they can check our papers, like what are the difficulty we faced and how we can successfully able to extract many contents using OCRs. And all, apart from that, also we collected some data from the existing corpora, like PM India. Recently, there was a corpus release with PM India, which is mostly prime minister's all the government policies. It is about government policies and available in all the languages. So that also we have taken some of these. And also some of the, and all the data we have taken from our old ODN Corp 1.0. So these are the, taking all these sources, we try to do the pre-processing. So if you look into the diagram, so most of the times we did the processing using using machine, but in case of OCR-based techniques, we have to do manual corrections because it's very difficult for any suitable tools or machines to exactly generate the English Odia parallel corpus, or because only human can read and properly make it suitable for this language corpus. So in one step, we do the manual correction, and all others we did using some scripts. And for the processing, mostly we have for HTML pages, we have scraped the using Python scripts. And for OCR,
we are still seeing only the first screen of yours. We are still seeing your first slide only. Can you go to the current slide you're
presenting? Yeah. So next we did some sentence segmentation where we have did the some sentence segmentation using all the big paragraphs we have splitted into sentence based on English full stop or Odia or full stop marks, or which called Purnabiram. And this is the final dataset size. So to just to know about this, what are the domain coverage? I have highlighted some of the domain which is covered by our datasets. And for using the-
Gandhiyabhraji, you have only 5 to 7 minutes left.
Yeah, almost I am finished, sir. So for the-
No, wait. We are only seeing your first slide. I think you have progressed to some other slide.
Maybe some problem, but already I think I have explained the slides.
Maybe there's a problem in this slide changing.
Yeah, so yeah, maybe I can share the slides, but I am already explained most of the slides. Now already 2 slides are remain for me.
Go to the last 2 slides we are printing. At least we can see something. Otherwise, it's only showing the first slide.
Yeah, so you have come to last slide. So can you come to some previous slides also?
You have to click on the left panel on the slide number.
Yeah. We can see the slides now. Yes.
So are you able to see my slides now?
Yeah.
So this is the data set size and the domain which cover the data. And next is about the baseline. So in the baseline, we have distributed the whole data set into train, dev, and test, and it will be available in the same format for machine translations. And for NMT setup, we have used transformer model, which is implemented in OpenNMT PY. And if you look into, so we have measured the evaluation using Blue Score, which is a Sacrebull, which is a version of Blue. And as you can see the Blue Score, so mostly for English to Odia, it is comparatively less. And Odia to English, it is higher Blue Score, which we obtained. But still, we found that this Blue Score is not very competitive because of the size of the data set. So it is around 100K now still. And the data set, it will be available in the Lindat, which is a repository for all the resources. And in the conclusion, we can say that, okay, this data set, this year it will be part of the WAT 2020 for English Odia Machine Transmission Systems. So I'd like to tell if somebody's are working in the low resource languages or Indian languages translation systems, they can go and try our this data set. And the next step is that we want to extend by building an NMT system utilizing this with some other techniques like back translation or domain adaptation and releasing it for a non-commercial purpose so that others or general public can use it for this English to Odia or Odia to English machine translations. Yeah, so that's all from my side. So if any questions, so maybe I have some problem in the slides. I don't know why, but if you have any questions, you can feel free to ask me or you can send me mails, which definitely I'll be happy to respond.
Hello.
So you have finished, Professor Shantipriya?
Yeah, it's from my side, it's done.
Okay. So if there are any questions, we can have one or two quick questions from the audience.
Please close your presentation.
Yeah.
Please minimize.
Yes.
Let's see if there is anyone who is asking question. Please raise your hand like this. Like this.
Yeah. Professor Girish, you put your audio on, video on. Yeah, now it's okay.
Raise hand and unmute him or her for questions. Shiladitya, please send. Maybe I can ask a question to Shantipriya, but please speak closer to the microphone. Now you have released your data set on the GitHub, right?
Sir, the GitHub which we released, it's a
catalog.
Catalog, yeah.
Right.
Which contain all kind of resources exactly. Only specific to ODA.
Right. So what I have asked, I have asked my student who is also working on Odia, and we've done some work, to quickly look at the catalog and check if there is something that we can add to that also. Obviously, we can't add the IELTS. We have done, we can perhaps add it there.
Okay, sir. Yeah, it will be fine.
Right. And we also have Odia white paper for language. Maybe I'll ask Atul to send a copy to you for evaluation. And your feedback on that. Yes, white paper for Odia language technology.
Yeah, that will be really helpful, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Very nice. Thank you so much, Professor Shantipriya, for a very interesting paper. And Professor Girish, we can go to the next one missing paper. Is there or? There was one more missing paper. Paper number 4. Professor Girish, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah, so there was one more paper, number 4, which was missing earlier. And if the author is available and the system...
Okay, Mr. Group.
Yes, sir. I'm Vijay, I'm here, sir.
Please,
Able to hear me, sir? I'm Vijay.
Yeah, we can hear you. Can you put your video on?
Yes, sir, I'm doing it, sir.
Professor Agrawal, I suggest you know, yeah. This session ends at officially at
6:45.
So after this paper ends, we can have a 5-minute question answer. Anybody can ask question on any of the papers.
Okay.
And that will be a good.
Sure.
As usual, 7 o'clock.
Atul, can you share the slides for me? Atul ji?
Okay.
Enabled, I think. Mm-hmm. For all. Yes, enabled for all.
Yes. Yeah.
Good teacher. School karke mat.
Thank you, Atul ji. A very good evening to the one and all, and a big thanks to the organizers for arranging this in this odd hours. Really, in this situation, you are giving us a chance to present. It's really great. The paper title, able to hear me?
Yes. Please go ahead. Yeah.
The title of the paper is Handling Known Core Reference in Tamil. I'm Vijay Sundaram from AUKBC Research Center, working with Dr. Shobha Lalita Devi. Next slide, please. Next slide. Atul, next slide. Atul?
Yeah, it's there. Yes.
I have Atul, already shared.
Next slide is displayed here.
Atul ji, thank you. There's a delay, sorry. Before getting into the presentation, the outline of the presentation is going to be the objective of the work, what are core reference chains, our approach in building core, in building the now known RFR resolution, our experiments and the results, the error analysis we did, and the intrinsic errors of the system. Next slide, please. Natural language understanding is the most important requirement of the automatic text processing systems. For achieving this, the tools has to understand the coherence in the text. The core reference chains bring coherence to the text. The different reference markers, namely pronominals, reflexives, reciprocals, distributives, one anaphores, now known reference, bring cohesiveness to the text, and these form the core reference chains. Here we are going to focus on only now known anaphores, and we are going to deal about how to build a now known anaphore resolution system and the challenges in resolving it in Tamil. Next slide, please. Core reference chains are formed by grouping anaphoric expressions referring to the same entity. As we saw earlier, the different reference markers and their antecedents form the core reference chains. One of the earliest work in core reference resolution using machine learning was done by Soon et al. In 2000. It is one of the earliest work where they used a decision tree based approach. The various machine learning techniques used for this particular task are like decision trees, memory-based learning, conditional random fields, first-order probabilistic models, multi-sieve-based approach, and deep neural networks. Next slide, please. Before getting into the core part, let us see the characteristics of Tamil. Here we will discuss about few of the characteristics of Tamil. Tamil belongs to South Dravidian language family. it is a relatively free word order language, but in clausal constructions and noun phrases, the structure is fixed. It is a verb final language. The subject is mostly a nominative noun. Object is mostly an accusative noun. The Tamil can also have dative subjects in certain constructions. Tamil has person number gender agreement with subject and object. Unlike English, clausal constructions are introduced by non-finite verbs. Copula drops are allowed in Tamil, so verbless sentences are possible in Tamil. Genitive drop is also is common in Tamil. It makes the NP chunking task a challenging task. Though accusative marker denotes the object, it can also be dropped in certain constructions. Pro drop is one of the common characteristics in Tamil. Next slide, please. Our task here is to identify the referent of a noun which has already occurred in the document. The noun phrases may be repeated as a full noun phrase or a partial noun phrase, as an acronym or a semantically closed concept such as synonyms or superordinates. So in this task, we need to consider noun phrases which are named entities, acronyms, demonstrative noun phrases, and definite descriptions. Next slide, please. Here we have used conditional drum fields, a machine learning technique, to develop the system. As we know, a machine learning technique needs a training, a supervised machine learning technique needs a training of the testing data. The training data has positive and negative pairs of noun phrases which are referring and not referring. The positive pairs are the referring pairs, and negative pairs are the non-referring pairs. In the testing data, we prepare similar paths and give it to the system to identify it. So for the system to learn, we need to give features. So these features are collected from the pre-processing, after pre-processing the data. So we pre-process the data with syntactic modules and semantic module. Syntactic pipeline includes morph analyzer, part of speech tagger, chunker, and class bound identifier. And we use named entity recognizer, which is a semantic processing module. Next slide, please. One of the important thing in the machine learning is the identification of the features. Here we have used two sets of features. One is individual features, another is the comparison features. Individual features are like, it gives the characteristics of each NP. Is the NP as a single word or it has a multiple word? What are the POS tags of the NPs in the pair? What are the case markers in that? Because in Indian, in Tamil, we can make out the synthetic category of the noun phrase using the case marker attached to it. Then the any category, then the presence of demonstrative pronouns, because it is useful in identifying the common noun with the differentiating the common noun and the demonstrative nouns. Next slide, please. The comparison features are obtained by comparing the characteristics of both the NPs in the pair of NPs. Like the full string match, is the root word between both the strings, both the NPs are common. Partial string match, what is the percentage of commonality between the root words of NP1 and NP2, that is NPI and NPJ. The first word match between the NP1 and NP2. Similarly, last word match between the NPO, NPI and NPJ. The last one is last word match and the first word. Coming to the experiments and evaluation, we have used a corpus containing 1,000 news articles from collected from new Tamil news dailies. The news articles were pre-processed with the syntactic processing module synthetic processing pipeline, which starts with MAF analyzer to class boundary identifier, and then the named entities are tagged using a named entity recognizer. Once the pre-processing is done, we used Palinka, a graphical tool for tagging the noun and relations between the noun phrases. The statistics of the corpus is given here. The number of annotated articles are 1,000. Number of sentences, 22,382. Number of tokens, 2,72,450. Number of words, 2,27,615. Next slide, please. We divided the data into 80-20 for training and testing, and we performed the testing, and we found the system to work with a good precision and a little low recall. The precision was around 86.14, and the recall was 66.67. To understand why the recall is very low, we started to investigate the results and found a certain types of intrinsic errors the system had, which we were able to identify as 17.48% of the errors as intrinsic errors. Next slide. Apart from the intrinsic errors, the errors introduced by the pre-processing modules also contributed to the precision and the recall of the system, where we found the MAF analyzer's contribution is like 11.56, PO staggers is 18.78, Junker is 36.44, and the named entity recognition is 33.22. Here is a simple example where it shows how the chunking creates issue in the noun anaphora. The sentence is Arun Vijay Kapiluku Badilaga Thervu Seyyapattar Vijay Mudhalil Kalam Irangvar. Instead of Kapil, Arun Vijay is selected. Vijay will be the opener. So the Vijay in the second sentence refers to Arun Vijay in the first sentence. The chunker has wrongly chunked Arun as one chunk and Vijay Kapiluki as another chunk. The output we obtained from the system was Vijay Kapiluki and Vijay. Getting into the intrinsic errors, the very first error is the system couldn't handle the definite NPs. As Tamil do not have a definite marker, the NPs, definite NPs were also like next slide, please. Tamil do not have a definite marker, so the NPs occur as a common noun phrases. In this example, if you see, Manavargal Poratam Kadarkarayil Nadathinar, Kavalargal Manavargalai Kalaindhu Sella Seidhanar. The students did demonstrations in the beach. The police made the students to disperse. Here, Manavargal, which means their students, has occurred in both the sentence and it refers to the same entity. As there is no distinct marker, the system has identified it as a common noun and it didn't attempt to make to identify the relation between those two. Next slide, please. The other interesting problems are popular names, shortening of names, and usage of anglicized words. Gandhiji is very popularly known as Mahatma and Babuji. Similarly, Subhash Chandra Bose is called as Netaji, Vallabhbhai Patel, Iron Man of India. Other forms are like shortening of words. The place name like Tanjavur used to be written in a short form Tanjai. Similarly, Nagarkoil is written in a short form as Nellai. Trichinopoly, in the anglicized form, it is written as Trichy. Thiruvananthapuram, a place name, which is anglicized and written as Trivandrum. Similarly, Udagamandalam, a place name, is anglicized and written as Ooty. These kinds of popular names, shortened form of names, and anglicized names are used in the document without prior utterance of these kinds of words, which makes the system unable to identify its reference. To handle these kinds of popular names, shorter names, and anglicized forms, we need to have a certain kind of world knowledge to the system.
to handle to identify it. Next slide, please. The another major challenging part in Navnan anaphora is the spell variation. We remember the cricket captain Azharuddin. In the standard Tamil newspapers, Azharuddin was written in 6 to 7 forms. Azharuddin, 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 like that. It was written in 6 to 7 forms. Another problem in Tamil is they write the Tamil word without Sanskrit letters. Like if it is Raja, they write it as Rasa. So these kinds of variation in spelling creates challenge in identifying the known anaphores. This can be partly handled by introducing a kind of spell normalizer in the pre-processing stage itself. The other challenge is named entities are referred with a phrase which describes a named entity. Like Mumbai is described as India-vin Vartaga Thalainagaram. Mumbai is described as India's economical capital. Similarly, Kasi as Punitha Nagaram, as Kasi as a holy city. In the document, when the phrase occurs as holy city, we don't know that this holy city actually refers to a particular entity, Kasi. So to identify these kinds of things, we need to impart a kind of knowledge to the system to handle these things. Next slide, please. Another challenge in identifying the closely related, semantically closely related words. Another challenge is identifying the semantically closely related words. Here there are two sentences. Makkal mootha kaval thurainarodu murayittanar. Andha adhigarigal badilai yetru sentranar. People argued with the senior police people. Accepting the officer's answer, they left. Here the kaval thurainarodu and kaval adhigarigal refer to the same entities. But the system is not identifying it as it couldn't understand that the police people can also be referred as officers. So these kinds of noun phrases can be handled by introducing a certain kind of ontologies which imparts these kinds of knowledges. To summarize this, though we come up with a machine learning algorithm to identify the system, to identify the known relations in the document, the system requires more world knowledge and also certain rudimentary things like spell normalization to work robustly. Next slide. Thank you. Next slide. Hoja? So I'm done with the presentation.
Okay. So thank you, Mr. Vijay Sundar.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for waiting for me at different troubles. Thanks a lot, sir.
I know it's perfectly fine. There may be some technical problem. So can I go back to Professor Girish Jha?
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Agarwal, for agreeing to chair the session. Shobha could not connect you to broadband issues and problems there.
No, it's my pleasure. No problem. Yeah.